My talk will be essentially about some homology calculations, but it involves a lot of combinatorics in a sense that, first of all, these complexes we consider, or they are small subcomplexes, they at the same time carry some Lie structure, which is gradually algebras, and the Lie structure is kind of very nicely defined, can be described combinatorially. And of course, the other point where combinatorics involved is our proofs. So in the proof of the fact that homologies are sitting in one place in certain complexes, we use at some places of the proof, we use some arguments from non-commutative Gröbner basis theory for ideals kind of defined by differential in these complexes. So this is not just using programs, Gröbner basis computations for homologies. It is just elements of the proof where Gröbner basis theory gets involved. So, and these complexes we calculate, they appear from so-called pre-Calabi-Yau structures, which in turn appeared in open strings, and this structure was also present in many other places in algebraic geometry and in surjective geometry and in connection with mirror symmetry conjecture. But I will not talk about this. I will just give definition of pre-Calabi-Yau algebras as they appear initially and translated to the definition via higher cyclic Hochschild complex. I describe this small subcomplex which allow us to calculate essentially homologies of this higher cyclic Hochschild complex and show what is combinatorial description of Lie bracket on this small subcomplex. I will probably will not have time to show whole proof of the fact that this higher Hochschild complex have homologies. It is pure, so it have homologies concentrated only on one place. But I will give you a structure of the proof and show maybe some elements of the proof which where Gröbner basis is involved. And as a result of this purity proof, for this DGLie algebras of the complex, the higher Hochschild complex, we have a result of formality of this complex, so deformation theory kind of described by this. But this is a direct consequence of the fact that homologies are pure. You can argue more or less standard using this L infinity structures, which is obtained by homotopy transfer on homology, and the fact that homology is sitting in one place do not give you too much freedom, so it should be formal as a result. I probably will not talk about this, but the fact is that purity of the complex is very good property which allow you to have formality and all consequences for deformation, for deformations and so on and so forth. Now I will start with definition of pre-Calabi-Yau structure as it was given by Kantsevich Vlasopoulos and Zeidel some time ago. So this is kind of initial definition, which in a way have origins in string theory. This is defined as infinity structure on a direct sum of algebra and its dual shifted by 1 minus d. So this is when I talk in about pre-Calabi-Yau algebra, pre-Calabi-Yau algebra of dimension d. But I will not actually pay too much attention to shifts in this talk. It is kind of sometimes essential. So then this infinity structure on A plus A star should be cyclic invariant with respect on natural evaluation pairing on A plus A star, which means that if you take your form here, it is nth multiplication in your I-infinity structure and permute your arguments, so pull alpha 1 to the end, then the form is preserved. Modulo sine, which is minus 1 in power degree of alpha, multiplied by sum of degrees of all elements through which you pull this alpha, so sum of all these degrees. Here I use convention, shifted convention for this sign. Form itself is just evaluation form. So if you have element from A plus A star, where A is from A and F is from A star, then form is just evaluating of F on B and J on A with appropriate sign. And third requirement for in the definition is that A itself is A infinity subalgebra in A plus A star in this A infinity algebra structure which you have. It can be defined for A associative algebra, but also for A infinity, it doesn't matter. And then the notion can be reformulated in terms of this higher Hochschild complex. This reformulation, this allows many, it is kind of useful in many respects. So it allows applications of homological tools, and it's also allow extension of this notion by translating it. Everything in this terms of complex work categorically, so you can extend the area of application of the structure. And one point also important that here you suppose when you take A star, it is kind of better to suppose that A is finite dimensional or at least have finite dimensional graded components, because only then otherwise A star can give you some problems. It's not dual, it's not the same as A, and so on and so forth in infinite dimensional case. But in formulations in terms of high Hochschild complex, this requirement, this finiteness requirement, it's not needed. Now this complex have many gradings. I give you slice of this complex of degree n capital and component of degree n in this slice. And this amounts to home from n capital copies of powers of A, which are mapped to nth power of A with certain additional structure, which I explain in a few minutes. So this complex actually comes from dualization of power of bar complex. So you dualize it by home as by modules over A in power n from nth copy of bar complex to this module an, with the following bimodal structure on it. So this is kind of important point in all this formalization, that we endow this n copies of A by the following n bimodal structure. So we multiply element of An not as you would do naturally, just multiply each term from the right and from the left by corresponding term, but we twist second the element by which you multiply from the right. So you twist this b1 bn and multiply a1 xy to b2 and so on. And at the last term, you will get bn. So the left, the right multiple is twisted. This is this cyclic structure on nth power of A. So then this differential on bar complex, when you consider this as a Holmes over K, give you differential on this complex. And this elements of the complex kind of understood can be pictured as so to speak multi-operations, where you have for each group of entries Ri, you have one output from this module. So you have a cyclic set of operations with Ri inputs and number of this operation is n capital, and they are kind of situated cyclically on the circle. So, and sum of all inputs is this small n, which is a give you gradient of your slice of the complex. So, of course, for n capital equal to one, you have the complex to A, as here A is only in one copy, you do not have any special cyclic structure on it. So you have just usual Holm, which is Hochschild complex, usual Hochschild complex. So now we do a little bit improvement on this complex. Namely, we consider now that complex was high Hochschild, and this is high cyclic Hochschild complex. So we consider not all elements of Holm, but only some of them. So if you consider this operation as this wheel of elementary operations, then there is natural action of group Zn on this multi-operation. Namely, you can turn this wheel such that two outputs coincide and some sign to this turning. This is how that n acts on Holmes in previous in Hochschild complex, in high Hochschild complex. And when we consider only operations which are invariant under this turning, then we get elements of higher cyclic Hochschild complex. Now I always operated with the slices. So now let's take a kind of bigger picture. So n is not restricted. We take any n. So number of inputs can be arbitrary. but number is outputs of outputs fixed, then we have a slice of complex, and then we can take arbitrary number of outputs as well. So we have infinite again sum or product, infinite product of the subcomplexes. This give you a whole Hochschild complex. And the Lie structure on this high Hochschild complex is defined quite naturally, again, in this interpretation of elements of the such wheels. So you have a graded pre-Lie structure on such wheels defined by inserting of one output of one operation to all inputs of another operation with appropriate sign. This is graded pre-Lie algebra. And then if you take a weighted Lie algebra, AB minus BA is sign, you get a graded Lie algebra structure on this high Hochschild complex and high cyclic Hochschild complex on both. So, then what will be in terms of high Hochschild complex definition of Pre-Calabi-Yau structure? It is element of high cyclic Hochschild complex shifted, which is a solution to our Cartan equation in this Lie algebra. Yeah. So now let us consider small subcomplex in this high Hochschild complex, which we will use to calculate to show that high Hochschild complex is poor. And also, it will be Lie subalgebra, and not only Lie subalgebra, but Lie structure on this Lie subalgebra is described combinatorially via this highly non-commutative words or xi delta Manov, as how we call them. This small subcomplex appear from a well-known quotient of the bar complex, which is this small resolution. Here is a kernel of multiplication in algebra A. This is a kind of starting point for defining this non-commutative field. Then we define this subcomplex zeta over algebra A as by modul home over A in power n from power of this resolution to the same modul as I described before, and take again invariance under that n epsilon. This is our small complex zeta or n slice, capital N slice of this complex inside high Hochschild complex. And this is a quasi-isomorphic subcomplex in case algebra is smooth, because if in a sense that the kernel of multiplication in this of this algebra is projective arbitrary module, then it is quasi-isomorphic subcomplex, so it can be used for homology calculations. So now we need to choose some basis in this complex data, and this basis on initial complex, which consists of the axis, which is this difference, so number of axes is equal to number of generators, a number of the axes is equal to number of axes generators of algebra A, this of from here we denote that xi star, let's say at this point to describe the basis in zeta n, we also pass from arbitrary smooth algebra to let's say for now free algebra, but it is also can be done for pass algebra of quivers, most of them. So I will tell later more precisely. Now let's think of A as free algebra on n generators, xi, x of in R generators, xi, xr. So basis will consist of following monomials, which are again written in a circle, monomials with labels. So you can have labels delta, number of deltas is the same as number of x's as generators of free algebra. And there could be some xi's as a type of labels in your word. Here it is one, but it could be any number of labels xi. And in between, there are words from monomials from free algebra. U1, U2, U n, whatever are monomials from free algebra. So these are our non-commutative words which form a basis in small subcomplex zeta. And now we want to embed precisely, to fix some embedding of this complex zeta to Hausdorff complex. For that, we should specify how element of the basis of xi produce for you operation element of Hausdorff complex, which is this multi-operation. And this we do in the following way. We define, let's say in this picture, we take xi delta word, which contain three deltas and two xi's. And this word will define for us a map from a cube to a in power 5 in the following way. So we have three inputs, three, let's say, monomials from free algebra. And we glue them to deltas with by axis. In these words, we glue them to deltas with the same index in some way first. So we found x, we found delta with the same index and glue them here. Then how, and do the same with all three words. Then how we read outputs of this operation. We suppose that there is some positive orientation on the plane, so all arches are here oriented clockwise. So outputs will be the following. Starting from nearest xi, we read part of initial xi delta monomial, and then the part of input word, which give you this word as a outcome, as a first outcome. This is this word here. Then here you read this word and this word till the nearest xi. This will you out, will give you output, second output. Here is the next output. And here, if there is no xi, you read word from output, then monomial itself, and then another output will give you, another input will give you next output. So this way you get five outputs. So number of outputs is the number of deltas in your word plus number of xi's, and number of inputs are number of deltas. And then you do this gluing in all possible ways and take linear combination of those. This define for you operation. So this word is input here. These two green words are green outputs here. This word is input here. This word is output, and so on and so forth. So you get element of Haier-Hochschild complex, which is a map from power three, but sometimes it's zero power of A, sometimes it's first power of A, to the number of outputs is five, so to A in power five. So this is realization of a non-commutative xi delta monomial as a operation. So it is kind of highly non-commutative monomial because you see you multiply what this operation does. You multiply this monomial, not like usual linear monomial, you can multiply from the right and from the left, but you can multiply this from certain number of sides which correspond to the number of deltas in this monomial. And then you get output, which is also not a plain, not two words or not plain word, but it is kind of tuple of monomials. I will give some more examples showing how it works. So now we embedded this small subcomplex in a particular way to our Haier-Hochschild complex. And note that in this embedding, we get only as elements of small subcomplex, we get only those homes where powers of A in this partition of power N, in this partition in the incoming element is can be only zero or one, as you can see here. So this is another characterization of subcomplex. So let me, to make it a little clearer, let me give one example of what can be obtained with help of this non-commutative words, elements of small subcomplex. So let's explain in this language this double Poisson bracket, which is known as a structure which allow non-commutative, kind of historically already known as a structure which allow a non-commutative Poisson bracket on representation spaces on algebra if you have this map from A square to A square on algebra, which satisfy this double Leibniz identity, double Jacobi and symmetry. So let us obtain this map from A square to A square from xi delta word, from non-commutative word. For that, we need to take word which contain two deltas and no xi's. Then you will have two inputs and they give you two outputs. So this will be mapped from a square to a square. And you can see that with this definition, you will automatically, if map obtained from Xi delta word, then this map automatically will satisfy Leibniz identity. Let me say right away that symmetry identity will come from the fact that we take the two invariants, and Jacobi identity will be additional condition which come from our Cartan equation. Why it will be satisfy double Leibniz identity? So double Leibniz identity says that if you in input plug some product of two elements, then what will happen? You kind of should multiply one part of this element to this element of tensor product here, and multiplication and the other way, and multiplication here on the this is element of A square, the structure of AB module on this A square, let's consider outer structure. So it means that if you multiply a product of AB by C from the left, you multiply left component, and if you multiply from the right, you multiply right component from the right. So if we have this notation, then Leibniz can be seen exactly from our interpretation of this operation given by Xi delta word as operation from the higher Hochschild complex I just described. So indeed, when you let your word here is product of two words, U1, U2. Then when you plug it here, in all possible ways, you can plug it in such a way that division border between these words U1 and U2 is kind of higher than point where you plug it, or lower than point where you plug it. So in the first case, you see that result of your operation is that you just perform operation on V and U2, and this glue this U1 to the beginning of the tensor product of the first from the left, you multiply the left component of the tensor product. And here you get from this sum of other type of elements in the sum, you get another sum on here. When U2 just multiplied from the right by the result of bracket between these two. This is a kind of simplest example how this pre-Calabi-Yau structures in form of high Hochschild complex or its subcomplex produce non-commutative Poisson structure or analogous things for bigger number of inputs. So now, what is the Li bracket on this non-commutative monodals? Let's take two monomials and compose them as we should interpret them as an operation, as a multi-operation, and compose them as multi-operations should be composed. So as I said before, this composition of insertions of all outputs to inputs the operation of composition of elements of high Hopf-Schild complex we just described before. So what this operation will mean for elements of subcomplex of higher of subcomplex zeta. So if we want to take a bracket of these two xi delta words, then actually surprisingly enough, in a way, it bracket of these two words as a obtained as a through the composition of elements of high Hochschild complex of the Wills, actually will give you element which again expressed via xi delta monomials. More precisely, how we do the following. So if we want to take bracket of, let's say, monomial A and monomial B, we glue any x from B to any delta from A with the same index, cut up on this place, xi and delta disappear, we open it up, and we get new xi delta monomial. We do this for all x's and deltas, sum up, and do insertion in another way for BA, and sum up again. So this will, this linear combination of new xi delta monomials obtained in such a way will express use the same operation on the level of high Hochschild complex as operation expressed by this combination of this new xi delta words. So here there is a picture which explained it in a way. So it shows that when you consider operations obtained, defined by this xi delta monomials, and whenever you take element which comes from outside of monomial itself, some, let's say, xi which is sitting in the output and do with this what you would do for Wills operations, in the difference between composition of these two operations, all such monomials, all such insertions of outside elements will cancel with some element from composition on the other way. So only actually the insertions which I showed before, insertions of elements of the xi delta monomial itself to each other, only they give result for the bracket. So this is how combinatorially one can see that this bracket is closed on subcomplex zeta. So now let me say something about homology calculations themselves. So we have this small subcomplex zeta and differential which comes from differential in high Hochschild complex, of course. We have both versions without taking invariance and beta invariance. So what we will prove? We will prove that for free algebra on number of variables bigger than or equal than 2, so it is not true for polynomial algebra invariable, or for path algebras of quiver with at least 2 vertices, this complex is poor, so homologies are sitting in one place. Differential in this complex, which comes from Hoeschel complex, looks like this. Elements of themselves in the itself is such a word from non-commutative algebra on variables xi, on variables deltas in the same quantity as xi and xi. And on such a word, our differential is just substitution of arbitrary xi, apart from the one which is sitting on the first place. So when U1 is empty, then it will be something a little bit different, a little twisted. But if xi is sitting inside the word, it is just gets substituted by this expression. Sum of commutators of x's and deltas. If xi is sitting in the first place, if there is no this ui or one here, then this xi is substituted by by commutator by the delta and x's, but this x gets into the end of the word, so you kind of get this expression after substitution of first xi, and then the rest other xi's are as before substituted by delta, and you take sum of this expression. Here we need sum. So as you see, this differential substitute xi's by deltas and x's. So we have cohomological grading by degree of delta on this complex, and homological grading on degree of cohomological grading by degree of xi, which gets smaller when you apply differential, and by degree of delta, it is homological grading, so you can get new deltas. And we will consider in this proof the slice of the complex which have fixed degree m by xi and delta. So what we essentially prove that all homologies of the complex are sitting here in degree zero in this cohomological grading by xi. So our kind of first main kind of basis of induction, let's say in general the proof is induction by M by we go by these slices here. So basis of induction is M equal to 2. For M equal to 1, there is homology sitting here, but if you put a arrow from K from the field here, then this homology disappear. So this is kind of trivial step. And here we start all our considerations. And I should say that in the whole prove the most kind of subtle place where we should ensure that homologies are vanishing is this place the closest to the place where homologies are sitting, which is, of course, not surprising. So here we will need more careful considerations, which using this Gröbner basis arguments mainly for degree of xi is equal to one. So what, again, about the structure of how we proceed, first step we do is a reduction to the complex with different differential, namely differential is straightened, so to speak. So we consider another differential which does not act differently on xi's, whether they are first or not first in the world, but it substitutes just all xi's by delta, and we take sum by all the substitutions. And first step, which is not difficult, we prove that actually we reduce the fact for this our complex. This is our main result, which we want to prove for our curly differential, that if or more precisely, yeah, okay, I should send you words also about, so we should prove result for the small complex with a curly differential. It will follow that for the complex where we take invariance under the 10 action, it is also true because this the 10 action commutes with differential. So if you turn this wheel differential, you can differentiate after or before, it doesn't matter. And then purity of the whole high Hochschild complex will follow from purity of this small subcomplex because it's quasi-isomorphic, as I already said. So now the main work will be done in the complex with straight differential, and reduction to the complex from the complex which we need with this twisted differential to the complex with straightened differential is not difficult, but here already we have some appearances of Gröbner basis considerations, namely for degree of element, xi degree of element bigger than two, so not in this difficult place, so to speak, but down in this down the picture, we have easy to see that we can reduce our differential to straightened differential. Okay, maybe I do not have time to say how, but it is really not difficult. And when we go to this place, this red place, red line in the complex grading, then we already get a bit more subtle consideration where we will work modulo the, so we get expression of differential modulo the ideal generated by our delta, which defined our differential. So so here we need to do something in this ideal, which is quite small one, so to speak. So it is close to free polynomials, but still equations for the Gröbner basis in this ideal allow us to proceed and again to get rid of this first psi in the expression and move psi to the left, model the image of the, by this, if element was from the kernel, then model the image, we move psi, and by this, getting closer to showing that image coincides with kernel, or in case of straightened differential, we just show we should not go all the way through moving this psi, but we just show that differential is actually the same. We can get rid of this first psi model or the image, so differentials, curly one and straight one, will be the same. So reduction does not use any induction by place of psi. So I wanted to show this reduction more precisely, but I think I do not have time anymore. Anyway, and then after we reduce, we proceed with the main proof for the straightened differential, which uses some facts about what are generators of Syzygy module for the ideal generated by, again, this delta here. So we again work in the quotient of free algebra by ideal generated by delta. And then it was mainly for free algebra, but then we can model some changes substituted by path algebras of Quiver, because this all theory of Syzygys and Gröbner basis are developed by Ed Green for arbitrary algebra with multiplicative basis. Path algebra is a particular case of this. There are only few subtle places. So here, for example, we consider polynomials, free polynomials on two types of variables, which is just free product of two free algebras. And in case of Quiver, it will be free product of Quiver path algebra times free algebra on deltas. And this should be presented somehow that as a quotient of another Quiver algebra, which is possible to do, and then we can proceed in this quotient of free algebra, and it works again. So yeah, thank you. I think I should stop here. I'm already over time.
Just 2 minutes, so it's okay. So thank you for your quite interesting talk. Questions, comments?
Yes, I have a small question. You just mentioned the free product of these two free algebras. In this, in the spirit of Kourosh?
Maybe. I mean, that you will not have relations between these two sets of generators.
Okay.
So if you multiply two free algebras, you get free algebras on the.
Okay, I understand you. You partition the alphabet in two. Okay.
Yeah.
I also have a question. So then you consider this Poisson structure, then you just have two circles, and then you just then you multiply, then you just take some break, and then it becomes one circle. Uh-huh. I just remember then, and we maybe some discuss Hopf algebra on positroids with Gerard and Christophe. Then it was also similar because positroids, they are characterized as necklaces. So this is just some permutation which is on the circle. And then we have to multiple just such circle permutation. And then we just also just have found some point where we have to glue, then we just make ball, and then it becomes one common circle. And so the question is any some relation to some algebra, which so you have abstract, but if we just consider some concrete algebra, for example, function on Grassmannian on something like this. So if we just do that, so what we will get? So have you in other ways? So if have you some examples with non-abstract, but then you just take some algebra A, for example, functions on some manifold, and then did your construction.
For example, this double Poisson bracket is an example, but it is kind of.
Because in cluster algebra,
it is not exactly the Lie, this operation which is considered the in Poisson structures. So for algebras, I'm not sure. I know some examples where. Namely, this Lie structure.
Yes, so some this geometry.
This would be interesting to know. And as for this positroids, you said that you glue this in a particular place, or you glue it by all possible places.
Oh, unfortunately, I forgot. Many years ago, I only just. Then I see this picture with Glinka. I see that somewhere I saw so many instances there.
It would be interesting.
I don't remember how we did. So.
To investigate. Can you give me some references of where?
I have to find maybe some notes. I don't think that we have paper, but we just there are some notes. I will try to find. Uh-huh. And there is in cluster algebra. I think there is also this. So this is Poisson structures, so maybe also double. So I think there is a work by Shapira and Weinstein. So they consider the different brackets, and then they, I don't remember, do they double these brackets, but maybe it also could be some geometric implementation of your theory.
I may have a kind of general question. You mentioned at the beginning a formality result, and there's a Poisson structure coming into the picture. Of course, these are double Poisson brackets, so it's quite different. Does it have a meaning to speak about quantization here? Or not at all?
Actually, what this formality is supposed to say that we actually kind of we have a description of this L infinity structure on the Dirichlet algebra. So you actually. All you can know about deformation functor as a result.
Yeah.
This is what it says about deformations. And this is not only actually double Poisson brackets, it's kind of poly Poisson brackets, so to speak. So this is kind of one of the points because about but it also says about double that kind of after homotopy, we know the picture. We know that there is only how this Dirichlet algebra as L infinity looks like.
Okay.
May I ask a question? What is about the small component? So is it homotopia isomorphic to the big one? In some occasions, or when?
Yeah, maybe you are right. I say it later that everything is. So it's homotopy. It's quasi isomorphic to the initial one for smooth algebras. For algebras, the kernel of multiplication is projective module over algebra, projective bimodal. Then these two resolutions, and you take homes, and they have the same homologies. So this is quasi isomorphism on these complexes.
Not only quasi.
So whenever you have smooth algebra. Say it again.
They are, and I understood that they are quasi isomorphic, but more than that, they are sometimes homotopy isomorphic.
Ah, yeah. This is maybe. Here I'm not sure. We use kind of argument for homotopy isomorphism to get formality, but it goes through the L infinity structures on homology, this homotopy transfer structure, and homotopy isomorphism of them. I'm not sure. I should think about this.
Okay, thank you.